So 3 multiplied by 10 minus 5, something like this one. Polarization is even smaller. For instance, for E component of polarization, which I will explain, what is this? It's 10% of the temperature fluctuation, maximum. So it's 10, as a level of 10 minus 6. You have to be able to measure this thing. And people already measured E component of polarization. But for B component of polarization, which you need to fight, yeah? If you want to prove the existence of the gravitational wave, you have to have even better accuracy, because what is expected from B component is 1% from the temperature fluctuations. So extremely tiny number. So you have to be able to measure things at the level of 10 minus 7. But you know, technology plus smart experimentalists will fulfill this task. So let me go to polarization. All background radiation, and let me show how it appears and what level we have to expect. And first, let me remind you what is polarization. Who still remembers what is polarization, Stokes parameters, etc.? Perhaps nobody. Because it's considered as one of the most boring topics in physics. Yeah, but you know that, in fact, even polarization you could do nicely when you use geometrical language. Say something like in general relativity, and you write everything not in terms of spherical harmonics, but in terms of metric, which is induced on celestial sphere, and you don't use this cosine sign everywhere. Okay, so polarization. Let me assume that you know nothing about it, yeah? And start from the very beginning. Polarization. I tried, by the way, to read papers which people write right now about polarization. I could understand nothing there, honestly speaking. After that, I opened Landau Lipschitz, has read 2 pages, and then, okay, it was much more efficient. So, first topic is polarization tensor. What is this? So let's assume that light come to us in the direction from the direction n, yeah? So it's vector, unit vector, which shows on celestial sphere. Now, if photon comes to us from this direction, then it's clear that the electric field vector is always directed perpendicular to the direction of the propagation of the photon. You see, and to describe this electric field vector, we will use basis of this celestial sphere, which consists of 2 unit vectors. So not unit, not necessarily unit. Let me take 2 arbitrary vectors, okay, which I will denote E1, okay, vector, and E2 vector. And this is electric field. So arbitrary electric field vector, okay, I could always decompose in component like this one, EA, EA basis vector, where A takes value 1, 2. Yeah? And these are components of the vector in an arbitrary basis. So you could think about celestial sphere, and then direction N on celestial sphere. And at every point of this celestial sphere, there is this basis of 2 vectors. Now, this thing, okay, completely characterized, for instance, linear polarized light. What does it mean, linear polarized, completely linear polarized light? It means that the vector, electric field vector, always point out in a certain direction. Or it's aligned along a certain direction, better to say, because electric field, of course, fluctuates, so it's changing direction, but it's always for the completely linear polarized line, it's always aligned along this line. What does it mean, completely unpolarized light? It means that with 50% or with equal probability, you could get actually all the possible directions here. Now, if light will be completely unpolarized, then all probabilities for different directions would be the same. If there is no circular polarization, And the circular polarization is not produced during recombination, okay, therefore I can forget about it. Then this light, or polarization of the light, could be completely characterized with the help of two-dimensional, or how it's called, wait, second rank tensor, which, or second rank tensor field, which is determined on this celestial sphere. So what is this second rank tensor? It's PAB, okay, by definition, is 1 divided by I. I will define what is this I. And then EA, EB, component of electric field, expectation value over the time interval, which is larger than the typical frequency of the photon, yeah, minus trace of this thing. So 1/2, then EC, EC, expectation value multiplied by GAB. So what is here GAB? GAB is scalar product of basis vectors on the celestial sphere, and it's normal scalar product in three-dimensional space, yeah? So it's, and this means that this is metric on the sphere, celestial sphere. Indices here are raised and lowered with the help of this metric on this celestial sphere. You see, if you would take, for instance, standard basis or theta phi coordinates, then you know what you would get for this tensor. It will be sinus squared and what the other component. Now, what is E? E is so-called intensity, and by definition, it's just EC, EC. You understand that I could take orthogonal basis here, and everything would be very simple. But you know that people use, instead of this thing, not completely orthonormal basis. They use orthogonal, but on sphere, people use usually the basis vectors, the vectors which are tangent to theta and phi, to meridian and parallels. You see?
The brackets mean that you're averaging
over time of the observation. So it comes to me from certain direction, yeah, and for instance, I observe it and then average over some time interval, which is larger than the frequency of the photon. And then when you look on the sky, okay, then of course you would get tensor field, two-dimensional tensor field on the sky, or on this celestial sphere. So this tensor field depends on the direction on the sky, and direction on the sky could be, for instance, characterized by theta and phi coordinates. You see? So this tensor field, okay, or this tensor at a given point is symmetric, of course. PAB is equal to PBA, and it's also traceless. Is equal to 0. You could see it immediately from the definition. So, how many independent components we have here? Two independent components, because it's 2x2 matrix, which is symmetric and traceless. Yeah, so three element, yeah, if there is no restriction on the trace, plus trace is equal to 0, so two independent components. Now, how we measure polarization normally? And how we can express the result of measurement through this polarization test. What we use? What did we use in the school? We used polarimeter, if you remember. Yeah, and we were rotating this polarimeter. And polarimeter has so-called main axis, okay, which is characterized by MA vector, two-dimensional. So then we rotate this. So this M vector is MA, again in the same basis, multiplied by EA. So if we are rotating or changing this axis, rotating polarimeter, and if light is polarized, and it's, okay, has certain temperature, then of course, depending on the orientation of polarimeter, the temperature will vary. Yeah? And variation of the temperature as a function of the direction in which This polarimeter is aligned, can be written down as proportional PAB multiplied by MA, MB. So you see, if light is not polarized, then, of course, you are getting zero here. So there is no temperature fluctuation depending on the orientation of polarimeter. If light is polarized, then temperature or household brightness temperature or intensity of the light which comes from the polarimeter depends on the orientation of this polarimeter. And if, for instance, if light would be polarized in this direction and you put polarimeter like this one, then intensity for this orientation would be equal to zero. So you see how things actually can be measured. Yeah.
So you have, I understand your intensity fluctuations, but that doesn't necessarily change your spectrum.
No, spectrum is not changed. So also temperature fluctuation I define, for instance, as so-called intensity, yeah? Intensity, how much energy, brightness temperature, something like this one. And therefore, when people, for instance, have this measurement, what they have? They have these polarimeters which are rotating like this one. You see, and then, for instance, one polarimeter shows in one direction of the sky, the other in the other sky, they are rotating like this one. And then they measure correlation of the fluctuations, okay, depending on the orientation of polarimeter. You see, now, the degree of polarization can be characterized by the number, which is called P, and which is minus 4 determinant of PAB matrix. Yeah, it stands for its matrix. And of course, for completely polarized light, it's equal 1. This is the reason why I explained coefficient minus 4 here. Yeah, calculate just determinant of this matrix for completely polarized light. And it's equal 0 for unpolarized, completely unpolarized light.
So what is the unit of
PAB? PAB is dimensionless because you see, it's electric field squared divided by electric field squared.
So then what is theta? Theta t then is also dimensionless.
Where? Theta phi?
No, theta t.
It's proportional. It's written proportional.
So
it's actually just proportional. You could actually divide it or multiply it by t0, for instance. Yeah? And then you will get correct units. So now, but it's convenient also to use not only polarization tensor, but also polarization vector. Why? Because it's very convenient to characterize the pattern of polarization on the sky in terms of polarization vector. And polarization vector usually is showing up in the direction where where the electric field is oriented in a preferable way. You see? If light is polarized, and there is one direction where intensity is maximum, when you actually, and in this direction, this polarization vector should be pointing up. Now, how to define polarization vector? Okay, let me just, it's some preliminary material, but after that we will go to practical application. Let's assume that degree of polarization is not equal to zero. Then consider the following eigenvalue problem. PA is equal lambda PB. So P will be polarization vector. So it's, what is this? It's eigenvalue of this matrix, which I call polarization tensor. Then I can normalize this polarization vector in such a way always that to pp squared, which is pc over pc, is nothing more than just two eigenvalues, appropriate eigenvalues. And then when I use this normalization for the polarization vector, I could rewrite polarization tensor just entirely in terms of polarization vector. You could verify yourself that PAB can be written down as PA multiplied by PB minus 1/2 P squared GAB. Why it's so? Just verify that this P is eigenvalue of this matrix. How you do it? Raise this index here, delta AB, equals, okay? And then multiply it by PA. Yeah? When you multiply it by PA, you will produce PA also multiplied by 1/2 P squared. So PA, as you know, corresponds to eigenvalue of this vector, which is equal 1/2 P squared. Right? Now there should be second independent eigenvector for this matrix, which should be orthogonal. And then you could verify very easily that this second vector is just perpendicular to PA, and it corresponds to the eigenvalue lambda, which should be what? Minus 1/2 P squared. Why? Because polarization tensor is traceless. You see? So you understand that you could use either polarization vector or polarization tensor to characterize the polarization of the radiation. Now you could also express polarization degree in terms of polarization vector, and it's nothing more than just P fourth, the absolute value of the polarization vector in power squared. Fourth, yeah? People use, in many cases, instead of this tensor, so-called Stokes parameters. And what are Stokes parameters normally? I just tell you and then we'll forget about it. So you can relate these things with the literature. There are two Stokes parameters which correspond to two components, independent components of this polarization tensor. And one is just 2i multiplied by P11, which is equal to minus 2i in P22. And the other, U, which is by definition minus 2i, P12. It's in the case when EA and B in the basis, okay? EA multiplied by AB, EB is just delta AB. So when I use orthonormal basis on the sphere, the Stokes parameters are defined in terms of the component of polarization tensor like this one. Now, why in this case, so then you use it on the sphere, you use normally as one vector, the vector which is perpendicular or tangent to theta, E1, yeah, E1 you use on the celestial sphere as E theta, okay, vector, which is nothing more than just E over D theta. So it's tangential, this is theta is changing, so it's phi is equal constant. Yeah, along the line where phi is constant. And the other is perpendicular. But you have to normalize it. So now, why we have to work with polarization tensor instead of polarization vector? What do you think? Why we won't work directly with polarization vector? And up to what extent polarization vector is useful? Clear that polarization vector, for instance, shows you that you have access of polarization or access of quanta with a direction along this polarization vector, with the direction of electric field along this polarization vector. So why we have to use polarization tensor, nevertheless? Why we have to use Stokes parameters, better to say? Because for incoherent light, Stokes parameters are additive. And polarization vector is not additive. It's square root of Stokes parameters. So E multiplied by PAB is additive for incoherent superposition. This is why we use this. And why we use vector? Because we want to get the pattern of the direction, preferable direction of electric field for the photons which will be polarized on the celestial sphere. But when we are making calculation, and when we will be doing calculation right now for the polarization which are produced, we will be using, okay, this thing. So now, how polarization appears at all? So let's consider Thompson scattering on free electrons, assuming that before there was no any polarization. Okay, let's assume that the last electron on which radiation scattered was here, and then the light came to me along direction n. But before it came from different direction, okay, L for instance, and light, let's assume, was completely polarized, so vector, electric field vector in this light was directed like this one, perpendicular to this thing, and it had the value, okay, E. Then, after scattering, it will be propagating like this one, and you could ask question, what is the value of electric field after this scattering in terms of the value of electric field here and in terms of these directions. Then you can open Landau-Lifshitz and you will find that electric field after scattering for this wave can be written down as some coefficient, constant coefficient, and then E, original vector multiplied by n, where n is direction from which light comes to me. Okay, so vector product multiplied by n. Okay. So nice formula. And by the way, the things about L direction is encoded here in this vector. So L didn't disappear from this expression. Just everything what we have to know about direction from which light came before it was scattered on the electron is encoded here. You see? Now you could calculate, you could take here basis. Okay, so this is my celestial sphere. On the sphere, I take basis of two vectors, okay, which are tangent to the sphere, EA, yeah? And then determine the component of electric field after the scattering. So it will be EA multiplied scalar product with EA. Now you use some simple algebra here, substitute this expression here, then you would get that it's nicely more than just A multiplied, okay, E, original value of electric field scalar product with EA. Okay? And EA, of course, is perpendicular to the direction F. This thing I use. So it's simple algebra which you could do yourself. Now it's for polarized, completely polarized light. Now, when we have this expression, what we can do? We can take completely unpolarized light. So it means that we assume that all directions here are equally probable, and then average over all directions. Okay? And then, after averaging over all directions for completely unpolarized light, which came from direction L, was scattered here, okay, we can calculate polarization tensor, which we will observe in this direction, if any polarization will appear at all. Yeah? So let's check. Will light, which is Thompson scattered on this electron, which was completely unpolarized, will get any polarization degree, or it will not get any polarization degree? Okay, so let's calculate EA after scattering multiplied by EB after scattering. Expectation value. So now averaged also overall original direction of this field E with equal probability. So you could make this exercise yourself. It's a problem in my book. I will write you just the result. E squared is the intensity of light, so it's modulus of the scalar field, which doesn't depend on polarization. As in here, you are getting GAB. It's the product of vectors EI on celestial sphere minus L scalar product with EI multiplied by L scalar product with EB. You see, original direction came here. How? via this vector, which is perpendicular to this original direction. It's a nice exercise, by the way, if you want to do it, to calculate and find this expectation value. And E squared, which is EI, EI, yeah, intensity EI, EI is just 1/2 A squared, and here you have E squared again, and here 1 plus LN scalar product squared. Also nice formula. Yeah? So N came from here also, again, because these two vectors are perpendicular to it. So you see that all information about N, L, etc. is encoded here. Therefore, you are getting the following polarization tensor from which was generated after completely unpolarized light, which came from direction L, was scattered by electron in the direction N. So, when you divide the one thing off to the other, you will get that it's 1/2 GAB 1 minus LN scalar product squared minus LER scalar product L multiplied by EB scalar product and divided by 1 plus LN scalar product squared. So, ask me what does it mean, this horrible formula, yeah? No, but it looks nice nevertheless, in spite of the fact that it works. In geometrical things, try to write it in terms of sinus, cos, it's horrible. It's really horrible, but now actually it looks complex. So, but you can take this thing now and calculate the term. And then what you would get? You would get the minus 4 determinant PAV is equal to 1 minus LN squared divided by 1 plus LN scalar product squared and all these things squared. So you see that if L is perpendicular to N, what you will get for this polarization tensor? You would get 1. Unbelievable. So, if light goes like this one, completely unpolarized, come in this direction, perpendicular, then it becomes completely polarized. And by the way, there is a very simple explanation, because you understand what does it mean, this kind of scattering. If electron is here, it goes here. If this is electric field is directed perpendicular to this plane, yeah? Then it moves the electron perpendicular to this plane. And when I observe here, I see the motion of the electron. But if, for instance, electric field is directed like this one, then it comes here, moves the electron like this, and it doesn't move for me, in fact. Yeah? And therefore, I do not see any light scattered to me. This is the reason for full polarization. And what follows from this formula for our everyday life? Look at the sun in the midday. And look on the light which scattered near the horizon. Then you could take polarimeter and then you would find the whole light which comes from the horizon in the midday. Okay, all photons have electric field which is direct parallel to the horizon. You see? So you could do this experiment yourself. We take just polarimeter and then rotate it, and then you will see that when you will rotate like this one polarimeter, then you will see no sun. It's like night will become if you look on the horizon in the midday. So now let's apply this formula to find out how polarization of background radiation is generated and when it's generated when we have this recombination process. In which conditions it's generated. So, you know that light before the beginning of recombination is completely unpolarized. Of course, from where you could get polarizations there on the first? No way. From viscosity you could get something, perhaps also, yeah. So before recombination, light is completely unpolarized. Now recombination starts. Yeah? And there can appear some polarization. Why there can appear some polarization? Look, let's assume now that there is this electron on which this last scattering of the photons, which came to me today, happened last time. Yeah? But on this electron, there were scattered some photons which came from this direction, from this direction, from this direction, this direction, this direction. And of course, this last scattering electron, which stands on recombination, gets photons, gets heated by photons from all different directions. And the intensity with which it's heated by the photons from different directions is characterized by some function which depends on L. Okay, L now is direction from which photons are coming to this electron which scatters them last time. If universe would be completely homogeneous and isotropic, then of course all directions would be equivalent and this function would not depend on L. But in the universe there are inhomogeneities and there is anisotropy. So imagine that you stand here together with this electron at the moment of recombination. And then when you look at different directions on the sky, because of this inhomogeneities, you see different intensity. So, light which is coming from different directions at the beginning is completely unpolarized. Now, after it's scattered, it comes to me in the direction N. And now what I want to calculate, what kind of polarization tensor I will generate as a function of N, function of the direction on the sky. So how could you calculate this? Now you use the fact that polarization tensor multiplied by intensity is additive quantity. And then for every direction, L on the sky, you use this formula, yeah, with weighted intensity, and then integrate over all angles. Because the quantity is additive, and at the beginning, light is completely unpolarized. Then what you would get, that polarization tensor today in the direction N on the celestial sphere is given by the following expression. It's 1/2 GAB, metric on two-dimensional sphere, 1 minus L N square. Correct. L E R minus minus here in brackets L E R L E B multiplied by intensity which depends on direction L D to L. So what I do here, integrate over direction, all direction for the photons which are coming to this electron to the moment of recombination. And then, of course, divide it by the similar quantity here, but also weighted over all possible directions. 1 plus Ln squared GL D to L. Now, if GL.
Why do you get two
integrals? No, up integral and down integral. Why? Because actually this quantity multiplied by P is additive, you see? So P multiplied by this thing, by intensity, is additive quantity, but not P itself. So you first multiply P by intensity, then integrate, and then divide. You see? Now, if GL is constant, okay, so since it's constant here, integrate over all L, what you would get, how do you think? Zero. So if light, which is coming on the electron at recombination, scattered on this electron at the last moment of time, Yeah, cars from all directions with equal probability, then from unpolarized light, you generate nothing. So, PAB is equal to zero. Now, let's assume that light is not polarized, not isotropic. What does it mean, not isotropic? How could you expand light on the sphere? Imagine that it's moment of recombination. You stand this electron here, and you observe from which side which radiation comes. Then, of course, intensity for the radiation you could expand in terms of spherical harmonics. And what does it mean in terms of spherical harmonics? In a simple way, yeah? GL is proportional. It's expansion in terms of powers of the direction L, roughly speaking, yeah? So what are spherical harmonics or combination of spherical harmonics in the other roots? Yeah, so here I will not write anything. How you are expanding this, okay? So first terms are like this one, quadratic in L. Next terms are cubic in L, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So in terms of spherical harmonic, it's the same thing as in terms of powers of L. Now, to which harmonic this LL corresponds? To which harmonic? Well, how we call this harmonic when we expand things in quadratic order in L? So-called quadrupole harmonic, yeah? Now, if you would take this kind of expression, substituted here, then you would find, okay, I will tell a result here. I don't remember how to see it, obviously. That only quadrupole harmonics contribute to polarization tensor. All other harmonics gives zero contribution. See, only the things which is quadratic in L, roughly speaking, or the appropriate part, okay, which is quadratic in L, from all harmonics contributes to the quadrupole, contributes to the polarization tensor.
Isn't it because you think that you multiply your J function with quadratic in L, so it's in some sense things.
Yeah, but why L cube, L fourth, etc.
But because there are designed polynomials.
Okay, you explain. Yeah. Well, so you see that only this quadrupole component of anisotropy which this poor electron, which is heated from all directions, see at the moment of recombination, contributes to polarization. You see? Now, before recombination starts, what is quadrupole? There is no quadrupole because sound waves, so they move only like this one, yeah? So there is only dipole. Therefore, quadrupole component could be generated only after electron started or photon started to feel themselves a little bit free, guys. You see? And then all quadrupole components which will be generated, okay, quadrupole components which will be generated in the process of recombination would generate also polarization. But for polarization, what we need, if you want to generate it? First of all, we need already produce quadrupole component of anisotropy for this poor electron. And second thing, this radiation has still chance to scatter on this electron. Two conditions, if you want to produce polarization. If recombination is instantaneous, would you get any polarization or not? Before the beginning of instantaneous recombination, there is no quadrupole component. If recombination happened and the photons became free, there is no chance for the photons to scatter on the electron. Therefore, if recombination is instantaneous, the produced polarization would be precisely equal to zero. On one side, because there is no quadrupole, on the other side, because there is no chance to scatter. Because to produce polarization, you have to scatter plus have quadrupole. Now, if recombination is not instantaneous, and it started, yeah? A little bit. There, at the beginning, there will be produced quadrupole component of polarization, but there will be still chance for this radiation to scatter on the electron. Therefore, where most of polarization you expect to be produced? Somewhere in the middle of recombination, when these two competing things, really come in agreement with each other. So on one side, already you generated enough quadrupole. On the other side, still there is some chance to be scattered on the electron. And in fact, most of polarization comes from the moment, in the middle of the layer of recombination. If recombination happens between that is 1,200 and 900, then most of polarization is produced at Z equal 1,100. 1,050, something like this one. Because there are two balancing things. Now, let's consider, let's derive formula for polarization now in terms of the primordial spectra, and then we see what is this. So how can I write formula for the intensity at recombination? At recombination, you understand why I have this formula at recombination, because this mass scattering at recombination. G, for the given electron, at the moment at L, last scattering, this at last scattering is only approximately equal to at recombination, because recombination is a delayed, continuous process. And this at L is precise moment of time when last scattering happened. In direction L, for the given electron, can be written down as proportionally T0 plus delta T, which comes to scattered on the electron at this moment of time from direction L. You see, temperature in different direction for the given electron varies. Depends on L. And it's in power fourth. Now, substitute this expression here, linearize this thing in terms of delta T over T, and what you would get for the final result for polarization. You would get the following result, that PAB observed today in the direction N on the sky is equal 3 GAB metric on the sphere, integral. 3 integral, the 1/2 GAB 1 minus LN squared or without squared? We've already squared, I guess. Should write this one. Minus LER LEB close brackets multiplied by delta T over T at the moment eta L, when the electron was scattered in direction L, which electron observed, because here also we integrate over D2L over 4 pi, So, you see, because it's intensity from different direction. And what should come here else? Should come the probability that these photons, which came from direction L, were scattered. Because this polarization would be proportional to the anisotropy, quadruple component of the anisotropy, multiplied by the probability that we still had some scattering. This probability can be calculated, and it's given so-called by thickness function, which characterizes the probability of the scattering of photon during this delayed recombination. And it's written down like this one. Mu prime means the derivative with respect to conformal time, which depends on eta L tilde, multiplied by exponent minus mu, which depends on eta L tilde, d eta L tilde. What is this function? It's function which characterizes finite thickness of recombination, and I will draw you how it looks like graphically. So where is... okay. Good. So it looks like following this function, okay? Mu prime multiplied by minus mu. It looks like following as a function of redshift. So it has maximum, okay, at the moment of eta r, okay, which corresponds to redshift about 1050. And its thickness is characterized by sigma eta r. And sigma parameter is of the order of 10 minus 1, 10 minus 2. You see? Why this function is like this one? Because at the beginning, the plasma was completely opaque, so not transparent. Therefore, there was no probability for last scattering. Everything was scattered second time, okay, here. At small and big redshift. And at small redshift, plasma became transparent again, no probability of the things we were scattered on this electron last time. You understand? So, different reason. In one case, it's too dense. In the other case, it's too rare, household, too small concentration of the electrons. Okay, good. This is why function looks like this. Let me also analytically calculate it, but I can do that. Therefore, of course, you understand that the largest contribution to this integral comes from this layer between Z 900, okay, and 1200. Okay, recombination was proceeding like this one. And as I told you already, all E recombination is finite. There will be polarization. And of course, the polarization would depend on the detailed structure of this recombination process. Therefore, you can guess already that measuring polarization and comparing observation with the prediction of the theory of recombination, what we can find precise or verify precise detailed picture of recombination. And as I told you already, during recombination, what plays a very important role? These two quanta decay of 2s level, which comes with very small probability. In fact, it determines the rate of recombination. I don't know. Most of the people, when they write about recombination, they write about God knows what. Yeah? Only in people, perhaps you will find about this role of Lyman alpha quanta. Because he learned it in 67 from Zildovich. From Novikov and Chlopsky, yeah, for the Texas Symposium, and after that wrote paper, okay, which accompanied paper by Kurt Sunyaev Zeldovich. It's actually a very non-trivial thing, this recombination process, because far from equilibrium started, perhaps the only place in the nature where two quantum decay of 2s levels of the hydrogen atom plays a very important role. And now you could see in observations of the fluctuation, you compare the result, okay, with the predictions, and you could see directly, verify this thing directly. You see? Now, what we have to substitute here for delta T over T at L? What is this? It's anisotropy of background radiation, which this guy, which is present at the moment of recombination, see in different direction on the sky. So how can we calculate this thing? This guy is not worse than we, right? So we can use for him the same formula as we used for ourselves to calculate this anisotropy, right? Just we now take this formula and apply to this electron, which lives somewhere in the middle of the layer of recombination. Therefore, delta T over T, which should be substituted here in this expression, can be written down like this one. Delta T over T in the location of electron, okay, which scattered this radiation at the moment at the L, in direction L, is equal by double integral. You will see why double. from phi k plus delta k over 4. You recognize the expression, right? Like this one. At the moment, eta l, earlier, of course, because everything for him was generated earlier. So now eta l plays the role of eta 0 in the previous formulas, and eta l plays the role of eta recombination. You see? Then exponent plus the terms here, then exponent e k x plus l eta l minus eta l tilde. So eta l tilde, as I tell again, analog of eta 0, because, okay, now we live with this electron, which scatters the things at this moment of time. And eta l, all previous moment of time, okay? From which this photon are coming. And then x is the position of electron now, and then multiplied by probability that electron was last scattered before it came to this other electron. Photon was last scattered before it came to this electron, which scattered it finally and sent to us. Okay, this probability is given by mu eta l multiplied by exponent minus mu eta l, then d eta l and d3k divided by 2 pi in power 3/2. So, and here a lot of terms. And here integration goes from eta 0 till eta l. You see? The only modification of the previous formula is this chance for the photon to come to this electron, yeah, which will scatter it to us and generate polarization, okay, from the moment of time eta l without any scattering. So it's similar to the previous formula in this sense. Now, look, you just take now, very simple, take this formula with 5 more terms, substitute it here, make 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 integration, and then you are getting result. But of course, okay, I'm already tired with the previous calculation, and also we don't need to know too much here, right? Computer do the rest of the job for us when we understand physics. You see that here also, quadrupole component, which we need here, was generated here. The things which depends on L squared was generated also only within this layer. Why? Because before this function was suppressing everything, yeah? Since there was no chance for the photon to travel for free. And when there appeared this chance, with small probability here within this layer, then there was generated quadrupole component. And from where, at which moment of time, okay, we started to effectively generate this quadrupole component. Take this term, L, eta, eta, L. It's clear that this function, which characterizes you, or which gives you probability that there was no scattering between these two moments of time, okay, could be or different from zero for eta L minus eta L tilde, okay, which is of the order of sigma multiplied by eta L. Sigma is 10 minus 1, 10 minus 2, you see? You understand? Because outside this interval, which characterizes the sequence of recombination, this thing was suppressing everything. You see? And then you could estimate for this interval what would be the contribution of this thing to quadrupole component. You just expand it in terms of L. And then you are getting that this thing is K eta recombination squared L squared sigma squared, yeah? When you expand this exponent up to the second order in L, right? So you expect that the quadrupole component, which will be generated, will be of the order of sigma compared to the temperature fluctuations, because the rest is giving you temperature fluctuations at this moment of time. Clear? Clear. and by which perturbations this quadrupole component will be generated are most by perturbation for which k eta r is of the order of what? You see? So, quadrupole component for this guy, for the electron which absorbs its radiation, which is heated him, will be generated mostly by inhomogeneities with the scale of the order of the horizon scale for this electron at the moment of recombination. It's not surprising, of course, because quadrupole component is variation on the scales of the order of one. Therefore, you expect that inhomogeneities which are responsible for that should be comparable with the scale of the horizon. The other thing, okay, you are getting that polarization, or delta T over T, will be suppressed compared to the temperature fluctuations, okay, which we observe today, by the factor which is proportional to the duration of recombination. So it's of the order of 10 minus 1, 10 minus 2. This is the reason why I told you from the very beginning that the polarization degree of this radiation is of the order of 1 till 10% of the total temperature fluctuations. You see? So there is a certain direction on the sky where, with the help of polarimeters, you are getting excess to this brightness temperature only by 1% or 2%, yeah? Compared to these temperature fluctuations. Negligibly small amount. And people nevertheless measured it already, because for E component of polarization, I will speak about E component and P component in a minute, it's about 10%. So 10% polarization people can measure, and then they can measure even correlation between this polarization in two different skies on points in the sky, and then can compare this measurement with observations. Now, so you see that polarization is a great thing and precisely gives us information or delivers us information, for instance, about recombination. This is one thing why it's good. Another thing why it's good, because it can allow us to measure the presence of the gravitational waves, long-wave gravitational wave, with the scale of the order of horizon at the moment of recombination. And this gravitational wave could be produced only on inflation. How it can be? Okay, so next, last topic of my course is E and B polarization modes. What is this? So E and B polarization modes. You see, of course, everything what we could measure in principle, we could measure in total these kind of correlation functions. Yeah, N1, PAB, N2. Direction on the sky. It's similar to the temperature correlation functions, as you understand, and also because this quadrupole component is produced by perturbation with the scale of the order of the horizon, there should be correlation of polarization in this direction and in this direction, at least on the scale which corresponds to the scale of the global scale, which corresponds to the scale of the horizon at the moment of recombination. Yeah? But this is second-rank tensor traceless. Instead, it has only two independent components. Here, of course, if I would use these tensors, then if I would like to expand it in terms of spherical harmonics, which spherical harmonic I have to use? Tensor spherical harmonics. So it's solution of two-dimensional Laplace equation on the sphere for tensor. So horrible, yeah? So, but now, my tensor has only two independent components. Perhaps, using this tensor, I could build two scalars instead of this tensor, and use these scalars after that to expand everything in terms of normal scalar spherical harmonics. How can I build tensor here, scalar from this tensor? It's very easy, okay? So, its tensor field on the sky, P, And now I take existence of field E, A, B, and differentiate it twice, and contract indices on this field. What I will get? I will get scalar, and this scalar is called E component of polarization. What is the other way to build scalar from tensor, independent scalar? Who have any idea? Scalar we cannot build, but instead of scalar we can build pseudo-scalar. Yeah? And it's also very easy. Okay? We just take PBA, differentiate it over AC, and contract it with ECB, where epsilon CB is square root of G, 0, 0, 1, minus 1. It's so-called Levi-Civita simple. And we change psi when you make so-called not reflection, how it's called, yeah? Reflection. Symmetry, mirror, parity transformation, right. So, this thing is, of course, pseudo-scalar because it changes sign when we make parity transformation, yeah, and it has handedness. Now, instead of this kind of tensor, yeah, we can use two scalars. One is called E component, the other is B component of polarization. And of course, these two things you could expand in terms of spherical harmonics. But imagine that experimentalist made observation, yeah, of PAB, and then he needs to take second derivative of observations. I think it would be horrible, right? Therefore, what could you do? You could expand this thing in terms of spherical harmonics. Yeah, scalar spherical harmonics, right integral for the coefficients there, and then in the integrals you will have this thing multiplied by some spherical harmonics and then integral, right? And then the integral, how you could perform? Just make twice integration by parts and bring these indices on the scalar spherical harmonic. And what you would get as a result, instead of solving actually this Poisson equation in two-dimensional sphere, yeah, horrible, for the tensor mode, you would get tensor spherical harmonic in one go. In terms of so-called scalar spherical harmonic and derivative, covariant derivative. It's actually a nice trick, which you could learn, but it's no matter how to do it, okay, let's proceed with this thing. Now the next important statement, that B component of polarization is not generated by scalar perturbations. It is generated only by gravity wave. And E component is generated by both scalar perturbations and gravity wave. How to prove that B component is not generated by scalar perturbations? You see, let's take arbitrary scalar perturbation, okay, like this one, okay, in the direction of the vector k, okay? And let's assume that, okay, this direction coincide with the direction of observation. In principle, for any plane wave, okay, you could look in the appropriate direction, and then in this particular coordinate system, when you will get results, and you could add sum up all these plane waves, and then you will get result in the independent way for the polarization. Now, wait a minute. No, I did something stupid. Okay, so I want to observe it. Okay, so let's assume that plane wave is directed like this one, and this is z axis. Axis, I already forgot what I wrote here. And I observe the thing, okay, which was scattered I mean, quadrupole radiation was generated by this plane wave. Then it was scattered in the direction n, this quadrupole anisotropy, okay, and I am observing here. There, here is my celestial sphere. What are p theta phi component of polarization tensor in this case? Clearly, they should be proportional by k multiplied by e theta and k multiplied by e phi. These are the vectors which are tangential to theta coordinate and phi coordinate on the celestial sphere. So if I will decide the direction on the sphere like this one, what will be this thing? K is always orthogonal to the vector which points in the direction phi on the sky if I take axis like this one, yeah? So imagine sphere, K points out like this one, and theta angle or phi angle is like this one, goes around this K vector. Then it's clearly that the vector which is tangential to this phi coordinate or theta coordinate is always perpendicular to K. Therefore, this term is equal to zero, but doesn't matter in fact. And this term, here is cosinus theta, and then polarization tensor as a function of theta and phi has the following structure. Here is some function of theta. Here it's zero, here it's zero, and here is minus theta q, q as a function of theta multiplied by sinus squared theta. You see, it's generic form of polarization tensor for this plane wave. Now you can take it, can substitute, can calculate this covariant derivative, and then you would find that this is zero. So the contribution of one scalar mode is equal to zero. Because everything is linear, then it means that the contribution of all modes is equal to zero. Perhaps here I was not so clear, but doesn't matter. You have just to remember that B is equal to zero for the scalar perturbations. So scalar perturbations do not generate B component of polarization. For tensor perturbations, P theta phi is proportional to EIK. This is polarization tensor for scalar perturbations, for gravitational waves. So now I want to consider gravitational waves multiplied by E theta E phi. So here IK. And this is not equal to zero. As a result, B component is not equal to zero for gravity wave. For gravity wave. And the reason why it's so absolutely clear, because gravity wave have handles. So they distinguish between right and left. You see? And scalar perturbations do not distinguish between right and left. If I would take, for instance, the pattern of polarization, if I would calculate the polarization vector for B component, for gravity wave and for scalar perturbation, then for scalar perturbation, I know that this matrix has this form, and then you could find eigenvectors for this matrix. And these eigenvectors are two vectors. Either orthogonal to, not orthogonal, tangent to meridian or to parabola. Therefore, for E component, okay, E component of polarization tensor, okay, the pattern of the polarization field could be either like this one, you see, or the other possibility, it could be like this one. See, two eigenvectors, okay? Because this matrix has eigenvector either E theta or E phi. Right? If I would have B component of polarization of gravity wave, then this off diagonal matrix element would be not equal zero, right? And it would mean the polarization vector should be combination of E theta and E phi. And then what we would find here, that for B component of polarization, I have the following picture. It's like this one. You see, I am really very good in drawing. Okay. So, four opposite directions. So, how can you do it? It's like this one, so like this one, perhaps. Okay, let me don't continue because you understand what I want to do. So, this actually has left orientation, this here has right orientation. So then you understand that now what you do, you make measurement on the sky, determine polarization tensor field or vector field, and then see, it distinguishes between left and right or doesn't distinguish between left and right. And then, if you want to determine gravity wave or to find gravity wave, what you need to do, you need to detect B component of polarization. Then, what people are going to measure, they are going to measure, I'm finishing in 5 minutes, so don't worry, different correlation functions, and some of them they measured already. For instance, okay, people could measure correlation function like ET. It's correlation between E component of polarization on the sky and temperature fluctuations. Okay, average over all directions. And this thing was measured already. First time it was perhaps measured by Chicago group. Then after this, there was this boomerang 2, where people discovered the existence of big E component of polarization on non-zero level. And the good result, relatively good result for E component of polarization, you obtained by WMAP 3. And the prediction for E component are in perfect agreement with observation. Moreover, WMAP 3, okay, detected also CEE component of polarization, like this one. E, M, 1, E, and 2. You see, it's correlation function between two quantities which are very small, because here it's the number of 10 minus 6 is multiplied by the number of the 10 minus 5. Here is the product of two numbers, 10 minus 6. Of course, you could tell me that if you want really to be sure that there is this E component, you have to see this thing, yeah? And people have seen this thing, but here the accuracy is still not so good, for instance, like here. And, as I told you already, there will be further improvement, and after the precise curve will be obtained there, you could be sure about precise process of recombinations. But, one, yeah. The B one, you said that the scalar didn't contribute, but how about the vector information? So vector do not exist, you see. Vector do not exist, therefore we can forget about them a little. Now, by the way, okay, I will tell about one more problem. Now, what is the next task? The next task, of course, very ambitious task, would be to detect BB component of polarization, which is BN1, BM2 correlation function. And what we expect for this BB mode? We expect the following thing. You see, what contributes to this BB component of polarization? Only gravity wave. Now, how polarization is generated? Polarization is generated because you generated in the process of non-instantaneous recombination quadrupole component. What is responsible for quadrupole component at the moment of recombination? The perturbation is the scale of the order of the horizon. So, in B component, the main contribution, the largest contribution, should come from the gravity wave with the scale of the order of horizon at recombination, and therefore the largest correlation we should expect on this scale. And if you would look, how is this CBB? Looks like, then, okay, it has some maxima on the scales of the order of 100 multiple moment, which correspond to the scale of the horizon, the moment of recombination. It decays here on larger scales, yeah? So on smaller multiple scale, because this perturbation of gravity wave with large scale do not contribute too much in the generation of quadrupole component of polarization. And it decays also here. Why? Because for small L, which gravity wave should contribute? With the scale much smaller than the horizon, right? But if perturbation of gravity wave enters horizon, what happens with it? It starts to decay in inverse proportion to scale factor. Yeah, you remember this thing I told you. Therefore, this thing is generated during recombination, the moment of recombination, and all gravity waves which entered horizon before already decayed. And they would be, in principle, responsible for the things in larger multiple or smaller angular scale. Therefore, the expected curve for BPP component is like this one. Now, for EE mode, it will be something like this one. Why here we have actually more things? Because here the amplitude of perturbation of delta T over T grows, if you remember, yeah? And this is the reason why in small scale also you generate actually substantial E component of polarization. Because stellar perturbation also contributes to E component. Now, if there would be secondary ionization close to us, what would happen here? Imagine that some electrons were, or some hydrogen were ionized again close to us. Then this radiation, which propagates for free, gets chance to be scattered again, right? And there is already quadrupole component generated for this radiation. This quadrupole component corresponds to the scales which are of the order of horizon at the moment of this last scattering. And this scale today we see on the sky at very low multiples of very large angular scales. Therefore, if there was secondary reionization, then 10-20% of photons get chance to be scattered, and again they will be polarized, and this curve will be changed here like this one. You see? So you have to find the trace of the secondary ionization. Now, what we have to do right now also in the next step, in the next experiment, we have to find here B component. There is one trouble with this B component. Take this pattern and then think about weak gravitational lensing. Weak gravitational lensing, of course, will deform everything here. So there will appear from this kind of picture, you could get a picture like this one. Yeah? And then you could generate from E component of polarization with this gravitational lensing, E component of polarization. On the other side, you know that weak gravitational lensing could be efficient only in small angular scale. And if you would look here, on this curve, then really this kind of weak gravitational lensing could saturate all of the effects here at very large multiples. But at multiples about 50, 100, we are still in the same zone. And therefore, our task now to measure B component of polarization. What does it mean to determine, okay, how much gravity wave we have, or to find gravity wave at all? And then, okay, everything is done for inflation, all predictions are confirmed. So last thing is, to improve the accuracy of the measuring of deviation of spectral orbitals from n equal 1 and to detect gravity wave. I'm not sure that actually the accuracy for B component will be good enough to determine the spectral gravity wave, but you have to find that test. Now, when it will be done? At the beginning, people were going, we're thinking about Planck measurement, but since the Planck measurement will be not good enough to determine B component. But on the other side, who knows? And there is also, there was experiment, okay, CFD4, which was planned for 2017, which is called CFD4 experiment. It was experiment, satellite experiment, just with the purpose to measure the component of polarization. It's still in work, by the way. It cost about, okay, not very much, about half or maybe 1 billion. Yeah, but nevertheless, when Weinberg says about this thing, okay, for instance, he said about LISA project, oh, it's already 2 billion, so people start to speak about serious money in astrophysics. So, here people start to speak about serious money in astrophysics. But you know that people also, or maybe technology, so smart that during the last several years, people developed very good detectors, and now they plan experiment, which is called SPIDER, balloon experiment, which perhaps will have enough sensitivity to see pick a point of polarization. It costs only 20 million, yeah? And it will be launched within the next 5 years. So, when these two tasks will be accomplished, experimenters already are asking, what we should do next? Yeah? Usually when we have this conversation, I feel, guys, it's not my problem because I also have a problem what to do next. But, you know that when this thing actually will be accomplished and when, okay, people will fight, what we have that, it would mean that one chapter, one more chapter in cosmology, perhaps the main chapter is accomplished and written already. But it doesn't mean, of course, that with this chapter, we verify M theory, N theory, F theory, or something like this one. It doesn't even mean that with this chapter, we will determine potential of scalar field. Because who knows, was it scalar field, high derivative gravity, or something else? And it has nothing to do, actually, with everything what I was talking about. It was only scalar field model, high derivative was only some kind of justification. That the things could be like this one. Everything what I will measure, effective equation of state, and everything what I will verify, the presence of the stage of accelerated expansion in our universe. Okay, so thank you very much. Course is over.